Welcome everyone to the first Search Mastery Speaker series iteration for fall 2021. We're exploring the foundations and practice of search, skills, education, and literacy. And today we're lucky enough to have Beth St Jean from the University of Maryland talking about HackHealth studies and how improving middle school students' digital health literacy. Just as a means of introduction, Dr. Beth St. Jean is an associate professor in the College of Information Studies. She's the associate director of the Information Policy and Access Center and an affiliate faculty member of the Horowitz Center for Health Literacy, all here at the University of Maryland. Beth holds a PhD in information and a master's degree in information with the Library and Information Science specialization from the University of Michigan School of Information. Her research aims to improve people's long-term health outlooks by exploring the important interrelationships among their health-related information behaviors, their health literacy, their health-related self-efficacy, and their health behaviors. So Beth, thank you so much for joining us. I know that the talk is going to be super interesting today. So we're happy to have you. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Marianne. And thank you for inviting me and thank you for attending, everybody. Good morning. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen.
Oh, I want to make one other comment to the attendees. If you have questions, you can put them in the chat or the Q&A. And if you want to chat with the entire group, the default setting is to attendees and panelists. So go ahead and change that if you want to address the group. The other thing is, I'm going to put pretty soon into the chat the some links to the studies that Beth will be talking about today. So you'll be able to grab those.
Thank you, Marianne.
Yep.
Okay. So our agenda. So we'll talk for a few minutes about HackHealth, what it is, how it started, and then I'll dive into three of our studies. So one is about health literacy and the different skills that the students face challenges with. The second one is all about the students' drawings of how they understand Google to work. And the third one is about the impacts of the program as identified by the children and their parents. So I'll start with an introduction to HackHealth. These are some pictures from our interactions with the children and the school librarians. So my colleagues, Dr. Megha Subramaniam and I, and several doctoral students, including Natalie Taylor, Christy Kodama, Rebecca Fullman, we worked with school librarians in the area, very local schools, all PG County middle schools. And we worked with school librarians to develop and run an after-school program called HackHealth. And Megha's daughter actually named it. she thought that was really cool. And the kids loved the name. They loved the name Hack, of course. And so our aims for the program were to increase students' interest in science, particularly in health, as well as their health and digital literacy levels and their health-related self-efficacy. So our work was funded with two grants from the National Library of Medicine. And we ran HackHealth over the 2013 to 2014 and 2014 to 2015 academic years. We ran it in five middle schools, and four of the five had very high free and reduced price meals, the percent of students who were enrolled in that. So they were lower from lower income families. And across the 2 years, we worked with more than 60 children ranging in age from 10 to 15. It was an 8-week program the first year. We raised that to 12 weeks the second year because we realized we couldn't get everything in that we wanted to get into the 8 weeks. And each HackHealth participant selected a pseudonym, which you'll be seeing those on some of the slides. And they also selected a personally relevant health topic that they wanted to focus on throughout the program. And then we worked with them to research that topic throughout the program. And at the close of the program, we invited the participants and their parents to the university for a party and also for some focus groups. So we could talk to the parents in one focus group, the children in another focus group to find out their thoughts about the program. And then students at the party, students shared what they had learned about their topics using whatever modality they wanted. And they were extremely creative. Of course, there were PowerPoints and Prezis and posters, but there were also plays, news broadcasts, songs, interpretive dances. They were amazing, amazing presentations. So we were looking at several different research questions, and we used an array of research methods, including participant observation, pre and post surveys, pre and post interviews, card sorting exercises, the focus groups. We also did a field experiment at one point. We collected browser logs, and we also designed and administered a digital health literacy assessment tool. So let's see, overall, we found that like many of our participants were unfamiliar with relevant health terminology, unaware of credible sources they could turn to for health information, unclear about how search engines actually work, and had some difficulties assessing the credibility of websites and the health information that they found online. So in the following slides, I'll be sharing three of our studies. And this is a picture of our HackHealth participants when they came to campus. Many of them really wanted to go to University of Maryland when they got older. So they were really excited to come to campus, and we gave them a tour, while they were present so that they could see the campus. Okay, these are all the people involved, and we would like to thank the NLM, the National Library of Medicine, the Information Policy and Access Center, and all the students and all the school librarians who participated with us. So the first study, Bit by Bit, and there's a link that Marianne will provide. It's a journal article in JMIR Research Protocols, Journal of Medical Internet Research. This started out as a presentation that we gave at ALIS, the Association for Library and Information Science Education. We won the 2015 ALIS LMC Paper Award for this submission, and then we subsequently wrote a much more extensive paper and published it in the JMIR Research Protocols. And I'd like to give a shout out to Christy Kodama for these slides. They're amazing and so creative. So these are Christy's creation. So what our goals were for the study, we wanted to look at the literature to see what are all the different skills that make up health literacy. There's so many, and studies they each had an array, and there were so many that we identified. And then we wanted to use that information to look at which of these skills were our HackHealth participants having troubles with, and then how could we help? So providing pedagogical recommendations for ourselves and for other people too, working with this population. So in 1999, the American Medical Association defined health literacy as basically reading and numbers, numeracy, so being able to use and understand numbers. But it actually it goes much further than that. And a more recent definition states that health literacy goes beyond that. It's many different types of skills and the ability to apply them within a health situation. So we took all the health literacy, we called them bits, but they're like skills, health literacy skills, and we formed this house. And so the house shows all the different skills that are comprised in health literacy. So starting at the bottom, above the key, there's two foundational layers. There's general abilities and characteristics, things like motivation, self-efficacy, and there's also information access. Those are foundational. They're necessary, but insufficient in and of themselves. And then if you go up to the house part, you'll see there's six different colors of bricks. And so the pink is information, need identification and question formulation. The very dark maroon is information searching. The kind of tannish, coffee-ish color is information comprehension. The lighter maroon is information assessment. The orange is information management. And the kind of cherry color is information use. And then each of those bricks has a particular skill that fits within those categories. So about HackHealth, the school librarians recruited the students to participate in the HackHealth. They use school-wide announcements, like on the loudspeaker, the principal would announce it. They also talked to health teachers and had referrals by homeroom teachers. And also sometimes kids would just come into the library and the librarian would get to know them. And they'd say, hey, do you want to participate in this? And so this graphic shows a breakdown by race, ethnicity. We had a really diverse group of participants. Majority had a computer at home, 73% had a computer at home, and most 70% had accessed the internet at home using at least one method, like their own or a parent's computer, a cell phone, and or a tablet. One thing that didn't occur to us, like on the questionnaire where we gathered this type of data, the pre-questionnaire, is that later we sometimes learned that although children would say, oh yeah, we have four computers, when you actually ask them, often some or all of them were broken, and that hadn't occurred to us to ask that. We used an approach called design-based research, which is commonly used in the learning sciences. And we, as researchers and school librarians, we actively collaborated in designing and implementing the learning programs and the relevant technologies. And we iteratively built on all of our prior data collection and the insights we had gained to inform our instruction and our subsequent design of the program. And so we continuously refined and developed the HackHealth literacy curriculum. And we used many different research methods throughout the program to gather our data. Some stats, lots of data. we used in vivo to do analysis. We did open coding. Most of the sessions, there were multiple researchers who went out to the school. And that really helped a lot because we each could take our own observation notes and then come back and meet and discuss what we had observed. And then we would develop like a shared code book and use it to code data. And we kept memos of all of our coding decisions. So now I'm going to walk through the challenges that the students had at each of these phases. So the first phase was information need identification and question formation phase. So sometimes they had difficulty understanding health terms. And this is just an example here. So this student, her pseudonym was Betty Boop. She wanted to know, how can women who have diabetes prevent passing diabetes to their newborn infant? And she ended up at this Medline article, but she came across all these words she didn't know, like bilirubin, I don't know them either, bilirubin and neonatal polycythemia. And so what she did is she opened another tab and she looked up bilirubin, but then when she's looking up bilirubin in the definition, there's hemoglobin, but what's hemoglobin? So she opens up another tab. And so what, you know, this sort of multi-tiered process, sometimes they ended up becoming very frustrated and not really remembering, like, what was my original question I was working on? So they also sometimes used less effective keyword searching strategies in the information search phase. They would sometimes use Google's autocomplete feature, even if it took them completely off topic and, you know, on some other topic. There seemed to be a belief that Google knew better than they did. And so they would listen to what Google was suggesting. They also used a lot of one word queries. So they would get huge amounts of results back and have to sift through them. So here's an example. The student just typed malaria and got back 48 million results. And they really relied heavily on word familiarity. So this student, she was looking up obesity, and what she did is she saw the ad on the right that says obesity information, and she said, well, it has information and that's what I want. So I'm going to go to the obesity information link. And that over-reliance on looking for words that they knew that they could understand, that was particularly prevalent among students who were from non-English speaking homes. So they tended to scan the search page, the search result page, looking for words that they knew. And then at the information comprehension phase, many of them had difficulty reading, comprehending, and recalling information. There was some inability to understand health terminology. They often didn't recognize some common health terms like symptoms, diagnosis, and disease. And sometimes there were misunderstandings. For example, many of the kids thought the MD, like in WebMD, that was Maryland, and not, it didn't, you know, they didn't know that that was doctor. They thought that was Maryland. They also had trouble filtering information and extracting just the relevant information. The majority quickly skimmed web pages and sometimes missed relevant information. And here's an example of that. So it actually says myth, eating too much sugar causes diabetes. But many of the kids read that very quickly and they said, yeah, they answered yes, eating too much sugar causes diabetes. And then in the information assessment phase, students had difficulty evaluating the credibility of information. They were aware for the most part that they should look at, like, does this have an author? But in this particular example, we asked the student, hey, is this page credible? And she said, well, yeah, it has an author. And so we said, well, who is Kathleen Doheny? And she's like, I don't know. It has an author. It seemed like the students were being taught the very, very basic, like, checklist kind of approach, which, you know, in many cases is not sufficient to tell you whether it was credible or not. Difficulty evaluating medium's credibility. So this one, little man, he said that he trusts this site because he saw Mrs. Obama talking about it in a TV ad, and Star Wars agreed with him. And she said, well, it's credible because Mrs. Obama said so. So there was sort of a celebrity kind of thing, or famous people kind of interpretation. Interestingly, some of the students interpreted specific kinds of functionality as meaning that it was credible. So for example, sorry, I ended up ahead of myself. Back, okay. So certain kinds of credibility. So this one had a listen functionality on it. And some of the students pointed to that and said, oh, it's credible because it has a listen. Similarly, if it had pictures, videos, it had a translate, it had a site search bar, the students tended to equate that with credibility. And then in the information management phase, a lot of times the students didn't take the time to organize the information they had found so that they could draw on it later when they went to create their project, their final project. This student, she was researching cancer, And she did take some notes, but they were all mixed up. Like there were different kinds of cancer and she didn't separate them. She just kind of took all notes in one block. We tried giving out these Cornell note sheets in our second year to help students keep track of what they were learning, but a lot of the students didn't use them. They didn't actually take any notes down, and they tended to rely on their memories. And then at the information use phase, many students were unaware of sort of the ethics around using information, so they sometimes used information without citing, and either they didn't know that they needed to, or they did know but they just forgot to cite, or they didn't know how to cite, and some of them didn't know the word plagiarism. Although one student said, when we asked her about citing, she said, "Oh yeah, I need to cite in case people want to know where the information came from." So she was aware. That was Andy Six. Those are what I just said. They would forget. That's Andy Six, sorry. Okay, so all of this comes down to like some recommendations that we formed based on the challenges we saw. So what we learned about the different challenges, we realized that students need help at various points, including at the phase of searching, at the phase of evaluation, when they're trying to manage the information they're finding, when they're trying to put the information to use. So including things like converting the information need into a query, knowing how Google works, the autocomplete and what the search engine result page layout kind of thing means, how to tell an ad, for example. Domain type differences, the .com versus .edu, and with basic health terminology, how to find date and author information on a website, and understanding that just seeing, oh yes, it has an author, that makes it credible. Not equating specific types of content or specific functionality as guaranteeing credibility. So how to tell whether information is relevant, credible, and useful, and how to tell how to differentiate between those terms, how to extract relevant information and take good notes, and the importance of cross-verifying information across multiple sources, and also knowing about plagiarism. So we were able to look at our modules. Our modules are available on our website. I think Marianne probably shared the link with you. So if anybody wants to download them, use them, they're freely available, please do. But we were able to look at our modules and make some changes so that we made sure that we covered these specific health literacy skills that the students were having some difficulties with. And we eventually developed what we called a digital health literacy assessment tool, because we thought, well, it'd be great to have an objective measure when the students first start of their health literacy, and then at the end, see how that had changed. There's really, when we looked at the literature, there's really not a lot been done about actual health literacy assessment for children. There's a lot of perceived, do I think I can do this? Am I a good searcher? Asking the students questions, but not an objective measure. So we developed this digital health literacy assessment tool, and we tried it out, I think, in one or two schools. Unfortunately, the way we had it was as a worksheet, and it felt to the students like a test. And so there's a need to make that an online format. And I actually had a student who was working on a thesis, and she took our assessment tool and she made it into an online game, a very cool online game. So our study definitely had some limitations, not generalizable. The tasks were imposed. It was in the school library setting. Some of the conclusions. So yeah, there's a very strong link between health literacy and health outcomes. Health literacy has actually been found to be an even stronger than predict a strong, an even stronger predictor of an individual's health than their income, their employment status, their education level, their race, or their ethnicity. So health literacy is extremely important. And we hoped by working with this aged, these aged children, that we'd have an opportunity to intervene in the loop between poor health literacy and poor health outcomes, which can reinforce health disparities actually across generations. Okay, I'm going to move on now to the next study. So our next study is where we asked the students to draw a picture of how they think Google works. These are just some pictures. So we basically wanted to get at their mental model, and people's mental models are important because that's what's guiding their interactions with the system. And as they interact with the system, the mental model gets revised and reformed as necessary. And Norman pointed out that it's very common for users' mental models to be messy and incomplete. So 26 children participated in this drawing activity. Excuse me, there were 12 boys and 14 girls. Most of them were aged 12 to 13. And our instructions, we tried to be very short in our instructions because we were trying not to influence what they drew, but it's probably not completely possible to not influence them. But we just said, please draw a picture or write down in words how you think Google works behind the scenes to find websites for people. And we gave them 20 minutes. And then we asked students to share their drawing with the group, show us, and then describe it for us, walk us through their drawings. And then we took all the drawings and we put them up in a room and we did sticky noting. So we coded the drawings using sticky notes as a group. And we ended up coming up with both a typology and a code book. So the typology, there's just six items and we were trying to code each drawing. Is it Google as people, Google as equipment, Google as connections, et cetera. But what we found is a lot of the drawings would have multiple that have, you know, equipment and the Google building and people. So what we did is we assigned a primary typology, a secondary, and then sometimes we even had a tertiary if it had, you know, many elements to it. And then in addition to the typology, we had a 14 item coding dictionary, and many of the drawings had multiple codes. But you can see from these numbers here that the most common codes at the top are computing equipment and anthropomorphism. And similarly, when you look at the numbers, drawings by the number of drawings by typology, Google as people was the most common. And I'm gonna show some examples of pictures in each of these categories that the students drew. So the most common, Google as people. This example, she said, this is smart people who know a lot of information. And she pointed to, look at, they have eyeglasses, they have ties, and their t-shirts, I don't know if you can see it, but their t-shirts say, I'm smart, look at me. And then in the green, I'm also smart. And you can see in the middle what she wrote on it. So very smart people. And this is another Google as people and how she described it. This is scientists at the Google answering scientific questions. And this one, people research stuff and send it to Google for them to post online. And you can see she's got people, she got buildings, she got equipment. So this was one of the multiple coding ones. This one was interesting. We actually used this as a title. You probably recognize it for our paper and presentation. So this student said, okay, there's a user who wants to learn about snakes. And so you've got the user on the top. And then at the bottom, he said, this is the creepy guy on the other end at Google, who's actually the algorithm that gives the user all the information about snakes. And then this one has the Google mini microchip helpers that pop up every time you open Google. So it's got a lot of anthropomorphism as well. Then the next category, Google is equipment, the second most common. So this student said, this is how Google works. You type in words and then the power comes from here and it'll be going to the computer that will start searching and give you results. So this student really emphasized the equipment aspect. And here's another one, Foxy57 said, I think when we research, there's like an image world that it's going around or the satellite that's going straight to space and searching up what we're looking for. And similarly, this student described this is a mobile phone, an antenna, and a receiver. You do a search up on your phone. I put in bike tricks, and then the antenna sends it to a receiver in the Google place where they have all the people working. I put info around the world and finish with the phone having a bunch of answers, starting with the most used and the most useful. So that's a really interesting conception of what Google's putting at the top of the search results. The next category, Google as connections. This student, this actually is a whole conversation. So Sweet Hershey Kiss drew a monitor, and it's a conversation between, she called Google Network, but it's Google, and a creator. And so it's basically someone who wants to make a website, and they're having a conversation with Google asking how to do it. And what this student said is, I think Google is created by, like, conversation wise. I mean, everybody has to have a conversation with something. I love her monitor. I would love a monitor like that. And then this student said, this is like the Google company where all of the Google technology is, and where you type up stuff on the computer, it automatically gets like a signal that you're searching something. And then they pick the websites that they think is best and they send it to the computer. And this one is two connected computers with a satellite that, what the student says, receives the message and tells me what I need to do. So the satellite is the sort of cone up in the top center. And then this one, the flash drew the Google headquarters, and you see the satellite dishes and the house on the drawing. And then Google as a physical space. This is a less common one, but still there were quite a few. Four of the drawings we put as primary to this one, and nine total had it somewhere in primary, secondary, or tertiary. So this one's very definitely the building, the Google company building. And then Captain Crunch drew the Google data centers, and he described it as the top 10 places that you wish to go, but you can't. And he said, they say that only a few people can enter because it's restricted, because it has all of the information about websites that are on Google. And then this one, very interestingly, this student said, you start from the bottom and you have the people slowly going up. So you have that one person on the bottom floor who figures out this information from somebody from the outside. And then he goes up to this guy who goes to the next guy. There's a man in the basement going through things like a social worker, except for like social media and other things. And he gives it up to like his boss, who tells his boss, who tells his boss, who knows a guy who tells the boss of Google, AKA the CEO, who tells him to put it all on Google. And then Google as interface. This one, you notice the personification again, the eyes on the monitor. And then this one, they drew what is cancer, and then how Google understands that as like what cancer is, what it is, really interesting. And a lot of the students actually took the time to draw the different colored letters like Google has, which was interesting. And then this one has the little fingers typing on the keyboard, and has some pictures of, you know, the web and some images that came up. And then Google as codes was, I think, the least common. And this one, the user types what is what is lung cancer, and the commands are represented as computer code, but note that there's a face on the CPU, there's a little smiley. And he said, the commands are in here and I made a little face for it. The person types, what is lung cancer? And then the search comes up with the answers. And then this person drew, again, computer code. I actually asked her, she said she was currently taking a computer programming class. So that made a lot of sense. So what we found is that their drawings, they're really creative, but there was some misunderstandings and a bit of limited understanding of how Google works. But it's really important to make sure that they are understanding them. And educators, of course, can help with that. But we also thought there's an important role for search engine developers and interface designers to make search processes more transparent and trustworthy to users, like thinking about the kids' words like creepy guy and guy in the basement. It makes you think that maybe it's not viewed as very, very trustworthy by some kids. And then there are definitely some limitations, small sample. Our instructions, I'm sure, influence the kids' drawings or their explanations. And their explanations might have been influenced by earlier explanations from the other students. Our sample, our findings definitely don't generalize beyond the students we worked with. Last study. So this study, we wanted to know like what impacts HackHealth was having. Our total participants, there were 63, and you could see a breakdown by race and ethnicity. This was across our 2 years. So we had very diverse sample. Most of our participants were like ages 11 to 14-ish. A lot of them wanted to go into a health career. So you can see here, quite a few wanted to be a doctor or a veterinarian, et cetera. We talked about methods. I'm just going to skip through that. We asked them, why did they join? And some students just said, I just want to join a after-school program. Some of them joined because they wanted the incentive money. We did give an incentive to the family to participate. Some joined because they had done it last year. So some of the schools we went into for 2 years. Some of them wanted to learn more about health or research or prepare for a health career, or they wanted to maintain or improve their health or the health of a loved one. And here's just some examples of participants and what topic they chose to investigate. Largely, they would pick a health condition because they had it, a family member had it, or may have it, or they wanted to prevent or help heal the condition, or they saw the condition mentioned on TV, book, radio, or they're curious. And so these are some examples. Agent Chicken Wings has Kawasaki disease, so she picked that. Soccer for Life had heard Ebola on the radio. And so she was curious, like, what is that? And Hope Keeper had hypothyroidism, so she wanted to research what that was. And this just shows all the students' topics. So you can see the more common ones are like sports injuries, heart attacks, asthma, sickle cell anemia, diabetes, HIV, AIDS, and breast cancer. So the short-term outcomes from the students, there were several that the students identified. So participating in HackHealth increased their interest in these kinds of things, enabled them to use what they had learned to help family and friends. And it also, helped with their health-related self-efficacy. They actually learned about health behaviors that can help to prevent or manage a health condition. And they also found out about trustworthy health websites. We taught Medline Plus, of course, and Kids Health and Mayo Clinic. They learned more about how to search the internet, to select search results, and to assess the credibility of online information. And all of them, when we asked, would you recommend it to other kids? They definitely said yes, that they would recommend it. And then we wanted to know what were the parents' views about the outcomes of their child participating. And so the parents said, well, they learned a lot while also enjoying themselves. They received assistance to think about and prepare for a future career in health. And they had something more productive to do with their time. They also became motivated to share what they had learned and sometimes changed their health behaviors. And sometimes they even influenced others to change their health behaviors as well, siblings, parents, et cetera. So basically overall, what we found with our Hack Health program is that each student's individual interest and motivation drove them to participate, and being able to tailor their work to personally and situationally relevant topics really helped, and it led to deeper engagement. And as their engagement deepened, it increased their knowledge and sometimes application of that knowledge as well. So it was overall a cycle, with the participants' interest and engagement in the program deepening and ultimately leading to the outcomes that we were just talking about. So the implications, we really learned a lot about the central importance of building on the particular participants' personal interests and ensuring the personal and situational relevance of both the content and the skills to attract and sustain a participant engagement. We had read a lot about similar sort of after-school programs, and a lot of them, they picked a health condition and they told the students, this semester, this term, we're going to focus on cancer, without really asking the students what they wanted to do. And everybody had to do the same topic. And it seemed that asking these students to pick their own topic really helped. It really helped them to be more interested and engaged, and it probably helped a lot with attrition as well. So we were able to tap into students' interests and personal situations to create very motivating, relevant, useful, and effective learning experiences and environments. And although the digital divide has decreased a lot, I think it's up to about 90% of US residences have internet access. There's still a gap. There's a researcher named Jenkins, I think it's Henry Jenkins, that talks about the participation gap, which definitely applied to our students. Although the digital divide isn't as prevalent, there's still a participation gap because many people, like our participants, had less opportunity to develop and use digital literacy skills, so they continued to be disadvantaged and excluded. So we need to facilitate digital literacy skills among youth, particularly youth who are disadvantaged, in order to foster effective and thoughtful searching, assessment, and use of online resources. Okay, so thank you again to IPAC, the National Library of Medicine, and all the people who participated, and all the school librarians who worked with us. And here's a full list of our participants. And we have a website, so please visit our website. So thank you very much. I'm happy to take any questions.
Well, I'll go ahead and start and make a comment while people are putting any questions or into the chat or the Q&A. I think it's astonishing that so many of the people who did those drawings took the time and trouble to create the Google logo with the actual colors and everything.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's something to learn from that how effective that is, or how they, like, I don't think a lot of adults would bother.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I don't think I would have even thought of it, but I think to the kids, it was fun and an important part of Google and what makes Google Google. That's hard to say.
It's just super, super interesting aspect of those drawings.
Yeah, super interesting.
Other questions? Everybody's quiet.
You can always email me.
Yeah.
If you think of anything.
Yeah. Oh, here's one from Katie Lolly.
Cool.
She's saying, in fact, let you make your comment. Hang on, I'm going to let you talk.
Sure.
Okay, go ahead. You should be ready. You should be okay.
Yeah, I just wanted to share like how amazing those drawings were. And I love the way that you categorize them into sort of the different perspectives that students take on, you know, what they think Google is Google people, is Google a building, is Google an algorithm? And I'm fascinated and surprised with the, you know, how variable those perceptions are. And if this was an Instagram account, I would subscribe to it and like look at it every day.
That's funny. Thanks, Katie. Yeah, they were super creative and really interesting and complex in how they viewed Google, you know, many different dimensions within many of the drawings. Yeah, I actually, there's more, of course, than what we've got in the slides. And when I teach, it's very relevant to the weeks I spend on information literacy. And so I bring the whole packet of the actual drawings and I pass them out to the students. And well, first I ask the students to draw their own pictures. I do the exact same activity and ask them to draw how they think Google works. And then once we see what they've drawn, then I pass them out and they can look through them and just, you know, I think the tangible aspect is actually important. They can turn it over. Sometimes the drawings have things on the back. So yeah, super interesting.
Yeah. And just a follow-up question. Have y'all had any conversations with our friends at Google about these interpretations and findings and your suggestions approaches that Google can take?
That's a great idea. We have not, but that's a great idea because I think the findings have some important implications. Like, I don't think Google would want this sort of reputation as a guy in the basement or the creepy guy. Mm-hmm. So they might want to do something to make things more transparent or something. But that's a great idea, Katie. Thank you. We should do that.
Yeah, thanks for the talk.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
We have a question from Jane, and I'm going to find her and let her make her comment.
Cool.
You should be ready, Jane.
Hi, so I was curious. So the program focused for the most part on formal information seeking, and I was curious if there was any discussion with the kid throughout the program or the kids and their parents during the focus groups about informal information seeking and how it may have affected their kids' research. But like, for example, did they ask their parents about the topic that they were searching for HackHealth, or did they hear something with the conversations like friends, parents, guardians, other loved ones that may have like broadened their vocabulary in their search or affected how they searched?
Yeah, thanks, Jane. That's a great question. So yeah, we were largely, because we were in the schools, we were really focused on more formal information seeking skills. But anecdotally, I can tell you, like from the focus groups with the parents, the kids were definitely like going home after the sessions and talking about what they were learning with the parents. Sometimes the parents like couldn't help because they didn't know the nitty gritty about the health condition either. But that would be interesting to get a broader look at all the different sources they were using. We did, when we first started out our first year, we tried to be broader than online. Like we wanted to, because we were doing it in school libraries, we wanted to use the school's books, right? And so we had activities where they would use the library's resources, but it didn't work out so well because a lot of the schools don't have a lot of money. And so their books are like from 50 years ago or even longer. And so the views on the health conditions, like a lot of it is outdated and it's like information that's incorrect now. We didn't know it at the time, but we tried to include an element of books, but still formal, but it would be interesting to get a broader picture of their whole array of sources.
One of our speakers from from the last speaker series. I think it was Jason Yip who talked about the experience of children navigating search for their parents. And that's kind of related to this yeah. question where the students may have been actually maybe even trying to help their parents with the health related topic that they were researching.
Yeah, that's a really good point, Marianne. We had this one girl, I felt really bad for her because her grandfather had died recently from a heart attack. And her father told her, hey, you and I are both going to have a heart attack and die. And she was really upset about that. Like, she, you know, didn't have the perspective to understand that, you know, it's not going to happen tomorrow. But she was really upset, particularly about her father. She didn't want to lose her father. And so she spent I forget if she was second year or first year, but she spent the 12 weeks or 8 weeks really researching how do you prevent like having a heart attack? How do you prevent heart disease? And I think she drove her father crazy, like telling him, don't eat this, don't eat that. But I mean, it was meant well.
Anybody else? If not, I will just pick up, share my screen. First of all, thank you, Beth.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Super, super interesting. Discussion. I'll let you guys know that we have a website. The Search Master Interest Group has a website, and you should be able to pretty easily find it on the Maryland University of Maryland iSchool research information pages. And we have another speaker series coming up, and it will be on October 21st. Same time, 11 to 12, there'll be an announcement where you can register. Doug Ord is going to present his work on searching the world, finding and using content in other languages, which I'm really, really looking forward to because international aspects of search are interesting and I need to learn more about them. So that's coming up. And otherwise, I wanna thank you for coming to the speaker series this time, and we hope to see you again in October. If you have any questions, my email address, you should be able to find me, Marianne Francis, through the university email. Otherwise, if you have questions, just give any of us a holler. So thanks again for coming.
Thank you, Marianne. Thank you, everybody.
Yep.